Council Budget Work Session to order. Mr. Dillon, since it's a formal meeting, you want to do roll call, please?
Yes, Mr. Gerard.
Present.
Mr. Devine.
Here.
Mr. Pezza.
Here.
Ms. Cullen.
Here.
Ms. Rodriguez.
Here.
Ms. Trammell.
Here.
Mr. Punske. Mr. De Giuseppe.
Okay.
Mr. De Giuseppe, while you're getting organized, can I do something very quickly? I promise I won't make a habit of this. My niece has never seen me on television before, and she's watching it right now, and I promised her I'd say hello, so.
I think that's against the FCC rules or something.
I remember saying yes.
My niece has never seen you. What a media that you are.
That's cute. I like it.
Really, your wife's sitting in front of the TV going, "Daddy."
She's watching it right now, yeah.
You're going to say that when your son's like, can, yeah.
Yeah, maybe I'll go.
Okay. Good.
Okay, so basically, we handed out a general fund budget, and the general fund basically controls the entire borough. The other funds aren't done yet because we are meeting a little earlier. They should be done, but I think every other fund besides this is really immaterial. Street lighting is a pass-through, the trash is a pass-through. Budgets like that just, there's not a lot of room for them anyway. So I hope everybody had the time to take this budget, get whatever questions you need answered in this budget. And Angie's here this evening, our, what do you want to be called, Angie, the accountant?
Finance director.
Finance director is here if we have any questions. So just to give you an overview of the budget, if you look on page 9 of 9, the ending fund balance for 12/31, we would be have a deficit of $726,680 if we use this exact budget that's presented in front of us this evening. Everybody understand where I'm looking at? The last line where it says fund, the ending fund balance 12/31. $26,680 in a deficit.
No. That's for 2015, we're out there.
Yes.
$29,000 for 14.
For 2014 is $28,923. Okay?
Can you get an extra copy of that?
So what we usually do is we go through page by page to see what you think numbers could be moved or moved around. So I don't know how you just want to do it this year. I'm sure everybody's knowledgeable enough, hopefully, to understand this budget. And if not, I wish you would have asked Angie questions over the last week or two. So does anybody have any questions on this before I start, or suggestions, or?
I mean, I would just think if you get the conversation generated, it might, you know, start leading some broader conversations.
Okay. So you start out with your revenue, real estate tax. I mean, I got to read every line here?
No.
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 So if you take each category, you're bringing in 2,595,500. The other category is 172,244, and you just keep following that down to the end of your money coming in, and you end up with, we are projecting, 4,502,164 on the revenue side. On the expense side, the end, is $5,199,922, which brings you to your deficit of $726,680. Because you got to bring the $28,923 deficit from this year up for, into the beginning fund balance and then your ending fund balance. Take some of these pages so I could get to it quicker. All right, so do you want me to keep talking or does somebody have suggestions or?
I guess I can just start the conversation with a few questions. Looking at I guess expenditures are the things obviously that if we're trying to keep things where they are, expenditures is where we got to look. Page 4 of 9, sorry. Legal fees, as far as 95,000 is concerned, is that anything out of the ordinary or is that just kind of is that a standard? Is that based on something we're anticipating or is that just pretty much a standard?
That's based on prior years. 2011 it was 93,000.
Right.
2012 it was 78,000. 2013 it was 92,000.
Right.
But also some of these legal expenditures may not necessarily be from the borough solicitor. You know,
right. No, I know.
Additional counsel and all on extraordinary items. So.
Yeah, and that was what my question was based on is that not at all on our solicitor, but on the fact that we have had some pretty extraordinary fees over the last couple of years, right? Do we anticipate those things existing this coming year?
I'm not aware of anything extraordinary at this time.
I guess my question is, were those 90,000, 92, 93, 94, 95, were they basically projected because we knew we had a bunch of those lawsuits that we were dealing with? And if so, is that a number that is something we can look at? That's the basis of my question.
I think every number is on the table.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's just a thought of mine. Again, having nothing to do with what we typically pay our solicitor, obviously, I think that's pretty standard. But more that I know we've had a lot of legal issues over the last few years that we've been dealing with, and maybe we don't have to project that's going to happen.
Anybody else?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, let me start this process because I don't think it's going to go anywhere. Before we get into cutting things and looking at things, I don't think there's a line item here except one category that there's really that money could be cut. I was looking at on page 1 where D transfers are. We're going to end this year at $155,000, and we budgeted $85,000. And don't forget, when the manager and Angie do these projections, they come in conservative, so they want to be lower because if they come in high and we don't meet them projections, then the whole budget could be out of whack. So I would like to just put some numbers on a table. I'd like to change that $85,000 and add $35,000 to it. So there's $35,000 there. I think that's being conservative. And if some of these places sell on the river or some other properties, I think that number could even exceed the 155.
Ralph, being in the construction business and probably knowing a little bit about real estate since your son, what's the phenomena there? Like why, and I'm sorry, Robin, you're obviously a real estate agent. So why did we bring in so much more revenue this year than we
there were more things sold?
Stocks and Lennox were the two main major transfers this year. If you look back in 2011, we got 76,000. 2012, 96. 2013, it's 90,000. So you know.
Yeah. Okay. Well,
and again, it's a guide. It's not
sure.
These numbers aren't etched in stone. And then on the borough permits, I think we could get to $100,000 easily, if not more, with some of these projects that are out there. So I was looking at $20,000 there. So now there's $55,000. Don't forget, we're looking for $726,000.
The building permits?
Yeah.
Add $20,000?
Yes.
For the 80 is Lorraine.
Okay, thank you.
And then I don't see anything until you get to page 4 of 9. Now, if anybody has anything between them pages?
We did get a notice from our investment firm on the $24 million. They, on page 2 of 9, they said the year-end projection would be about $224,000, not $240,000. But conversely, 2015, they're estimating $290,000. So that's an increase there. So,
and that's another 50.
So it's 50 there, but minus 20. So it's a net 30 within the 2 years, it looks like.
All right, so let's add that 30. Okay, now, does anybody have anything before page 4 of 9? On page 4 of 9, I would like to see if we could reduce the legal fees back to $80,000, which we budgeted for 2014, which we would cut that by $15,000. Because right now, we're only at $67,160. So we should come in around budget. So the solicitor's not raising his fee for us, and there was, like Greg said, a lot of extraordinary things last year with lawsuits and things like that. So I'd like to move that number back to the $80,000.
Okay. Can I ask a quick question to Andrew? I'm sorry if it's one of the ones I should have asked you before, but your year-end estimate, do you update that as we get closer to it, or is that just kind of an original?
No, I updated it.
So you have estimated there at 95 still. Is there, are we thinking that it's going to go up to 95 or?
I don't think so, but I'm just.
Okay,
being conservative.
Yes.
Okay.
Mr. President, real quick, before we go any further, on page 2 of 9, maybe this question could go to Mr. Dillon. Is there any movement on the cell tower? Or are we pretty.
No.
We still have two rungs, though, possible, correct?
They're there, but...
we're not getting no bites?
There are, matter of fact, some are trending away,
Really?
If you look, this year we're only budgeting $25,000.
That means we have one rung out of the three being used, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Anybody else on any other page? All right, back to page 4 of 9. I like that on the engineering fees, I like to try to cut them by $30,000 to bring that to 60. And I think we all got to be aware of, we just can't keep having people here for meetings for things that...
Absolutely.
To talk about.
So you're cutting that by $30,000?
I'd like to see that cut by $30,000.
And Ralph, can I just ask you, with the new construction, let's say down at Riverfront North, Stocks, et cetera, our engineer wouldn't be so much required?
Whatever he's involved in, any development, whether it's Stocks, we as builders have to pay that fee.
Oh, okay. Then that makes good sense then.
Did everybody understand what Robin just said?
No, I didn't hear her.
He said when an engineer comes out for a development, I said to her, the developer is responsible for all the engineering costs associated with that development. So if he comes out for Stocks and it's $200,000 worth of engineering costs, that the developer has to pay their time. That's why you put up money in escrow. Okay. So,
this is where we're at.
On the income side, that's basically, I don't see anything else that's really movable, and that's just me. So it's 30, 45.
135, Mr. DiGiuseppe.
135.
125, so we better look at that again.
50, 35, 20, and 30.
Okay. 55.
55.
I see where I messed up here. Wait a minute. 55
on a front page. 45 on page 4 of 9.
plus 30 on the pension.
All right, so what did you say, 135?
130.
135, you guys said?
No, not.
130.
If you add the 20, you're up to 150.
Right?
130.
So if you're keeping it.
I see where I messed up.
Are you adding the permits, Mr. DiGiuseppe, to that?
Yeah.
Add the 20,000 in permits?
On page one, I added 35,000 to D transfers.
Right.
And 20,000 in building permits.
Right.
So that's 55,000.
Yeah, right, then 30.
And then on page four, I added 45. So that's 100,000.
Right.
And the manager said he had 30.
On page two?
Yeah.
So right now, we got $130,000.
So we're only short $596,680.
That what it is, Rob?
Yeah, that's what we are.
Say it again. So $596,680.
The other 30 on page four, let me see.
Engineering fees down to 96.
Engineering, yeah.
Everybody following me so far? All right, before we get into the police budget, fire, I don't see anything. The borough, code enforcement, all that, I don't see any money that's a major savings there. If you get into page eight of nine, there's no removal. And we budget for 2014 was $40,000, and we spent $68,798 right now. So if we don't get any snow before the end of the year, we're already $28,798 over budget. So we put in $55,000 for next year. Again, that's unpredictable, so I don't want to touch anything there. If you look at the insurances and Eric Workman's comp and everything, that whole section has gone up by $55,916. So I don't, there's nothing we could do with that. So the only thing this budget comes down to right now is the police budget. Does anybody have anything else besides they want to talk about before I get into that?
I don't honestly, Ralph, see where we can. I mean, I've gone over it, I'm impressed that you came up with what you did, because I can't find any leeway here.
Ralph, what's the power squad? Is that when we had squad five?
Yes. All right, so I'm going to get into the police budget, or does anybody have?
Well, I mean, I just have a bigger philosophical, and I know it's controversial, and I recognize why it's controversial, I want to start there. But I just think it needs to be thrown out there on the table, at least for discussion. We've got $24 million in the bank. It's a really tight budget, and interest rates are not great. I don't know if there's ever a good time to take that $24 million, but there's certainly a better time than, take out of that $24 million, not, of course, take it all. But there are certainly better times than others. And in my estimation, a better time than other is when it's, when our budget is as tight as it is, and when interest rates are as low as they are. So we're not getting a great return on that $24 million. And we're in a pretty big deficit, and I don't think there's much want from council to raise taxes. And I do think there is a lot of want from council to get a few other things done out there as well. So I just want to throw it out there on the table, at least something that I think we should discuss, about whether or not there ever is a good time to do some sort of withdrawal of some of that money, a very limited sum, to both work on this budget, to get some relief for the taxpayers, and then maybe in the meantime, get some things done. You know, I look, of course, I look at the riverfront, I look at the Stocks project, and, you know, I'm so happy that that gentleman has moved forward with demolishing the building. But, you know, I think the revenue that we could generate from that place being built and being sold I mean, you know, the different units being sold, would probably outweigh the cost of us using some of that money for development projects along the riverfront, like the docks, and in the meantime, also, you know, using that sum, again, a very limited sum, to look at balancing the budget, look at our police issues, to look at a lot of things. And I know it would also probably, it would not probably, it would definitely reduce that number from, what, page two, Mr. Dillon, is that? The returned interest.
Right.
Obviously, if we took, you know, hypothetical, complete hypothetical, if we took a million out and it was 23 million, then that number, 241,000, is lower. So that would certainly affect this year's budget. So anyway, I just think it's a conversation that needs to be had.
Here's the argument I want to say about
yeah.
that. First of all, I think it has to be done by a referendum. Can council just take this money?
I think there's two ways of doing it. The current
Resolution calls for referendum, or this council could just adopt a new ordinance and get rid of that resolution. Okay, so that's
yeah.
one issue. The other option is, and I don't want to get into past and things like that, but you never take one-time revenue to balance a budget because you're going to have reoccurring expenses.
Right.
So if we take a million, let's just say we take $1 million out and we pay for the docks.
Right.
That's not a reoccurrence expense.
I disagree with you in one way. I you're absolutely right on the technicality of that is not a reoccurring expense. But I do think there should be some thought put into if we were to, and again, this I don't want this to be a conversation about the docks.
I understand.
The way I view it is the docks are part of it, but then so too is some relief for the people out there for the deficit that we have. I think you got to weigh the cost that we take that money out there, and that is a one-time cost, you're right, but then the recurring income that we get from the other projects that are developed because of it, such as
I'm not disagreeing that
yeah.
that's not an option.
Right.
The other option is, Mr. Gerard brought up about an earned income tax. Is that?
I brought up the local service tax.
Well, there's another option. Do you want to explore that, or is that something, is everybody in favor of? Who's in favor of an earned income tax?
That would be the 1%.
1%.
I'm not.
Is that, if I apologize for seeming really misinformed here, is that the one where we would split the money with the school board?
Yes.
No.
No, I thought no.
I mean,
not the first time.
Not
the first time they could.
No.
Yes.
But I'm saying,
is anybody in favor of an earned income
I'm
tax?
I'm not.
Okay, so then there is no earned income tax. Is anybody in favor of Mr. Gerard's plan for a head tax?
No.
What?
Well, let's talk about that. Does that, like, since I live in Bristol Borough, but I work at Pensbury, would that bring the Pensbury money to Bristol? My Pensbury
yes.
money that I'm already
yes.
paying. So that would bring in a lot of money, if you think of it. Like, he works, where do you work?
Chamonix.
That would bring his money out of the Chamonix to Bristol Borough. That would bring whoever works out of town's money that these people are getting here. I kind of like the idea.
Where there is a question is that if you are working in a place that currently does not take it at all, then it is a new tax for you. So right, and I guess it would be nice.
Right.
I know we can't find out exactly how many people that is, but if we could get a sense for, you know, in the general area, how many municipalities take this tax, I think we'd have a better idea of how many Bristolians are already paying this tax. Because, you know, I don't think anyone's looking for new taxes, but if 90% of us are already paying that and it's just going elsewhere, of course we'd want that to come here.
Yeah.
But if only 50% of us are paying it, then we are going to be raising taxes.
Well, if you base it right now on the $10 that everybody's paying.
Right.
They could tell you, what's that generally, 42,000?
34,000.
So that's
34,000, is that what you just said?
For 2014, yes.
So 340 people are paying it.
Okay.
If it's $10.
Yeah, good point. So that's not a lot. That's
so wait
lot
a minute, though. It times it by 42, right?
I brought that suggestion up to the council last year in order to maybe not raise property taxes. Because property taxes affects seniors. Local service tax only affects working people. And that's the reason. I might support a local service tax. I heard you say earlier in the year that
obviously, we're not going to be able to give anybody back any money on looking at this budget, but I did hear you earlier say that you'd like to give 5 mils back to the people. So if there's any way, if you establish this local service tax and we can give some property tax money back to the people, I'd probably vote for that.
Well, that's why I'm here, to see if you or anybody has a suggestion on how to close the $596,000 gap.
I guess my point is, I might be confused, but I think we're $500,000 in debt, so I think regardless of what we do, we're not giving any property owners back any taxes in any way. We're trying to fill a gap here.
I mean, there's 7 people sitting here. We're $600,000 in debt. This isn't, I mean, I have a couple suggestions. I don't think I could close the gap. But nobody wants to sit here and raise taxes. So what is the solution? Does anybody, I mean...
Well, I'm with Greg. I came in thinking this. I said it to you earlier. I think we should take out 1 million of that money we have and use it. I mean, I know it might not solve the problem next year, but... How long is that money?
The problem I have, Betty, everybody wants to say they want to sit here, and not everybody. They're not going to vote to raise taxes. They don't care what happens. We're not voting to raise taxes. Well, but nobody has a suggestion. So, you know, it's the same thing every year that we sit here and people, well, I'm not voting to raise taxes, so what do we do? Well, I'll give you my suggestion because nobody's going
to. Can we go back to I'm sorry.
I don't like the local service tax.
I want to talk about it for a second.
Yeah.
Okay. So you said 340 people are paying it? Is that what you said?
Roughly, yeah. Yes.
Okay, so it would be how many people paying it? If it would be a lot more people have to pay it, right? We're talking...
3,400 people. Talking 2 mils.
$135,000. 3,400
people. We're talking $135,000?
Yes.
I don't think that's
right. It's not a lot of money. No.
3,400 times $10 is 34,000. So there's 3,400.
I'm sorry. Okay, I thought you said 100. Okay,
okay, so now if we implemented the next phase of that, the 42...
Brings in 142,000... $1,428,000.
If we have 3,400 taxpayers who are currently paying it, that means that's a large percentage of our taxpayers that are currently paying it.
142,800. It would bring in 142,800.
It's basically 2 mils. Possibly. 2 mils, correct?
No, 1,400,000. Is that what he's saying?
No, it'd be
142,800.
Roughly the equivalent of 2 mils.
But I just want to make
it's
sure.
Just, he's floating it. That's all he's doing.
I just want to make sure one thing that we're making clear here, though, because if and Mr. Dillon, correct me if I'm wrong, and I'm sure you and Angie know these numbers better. But if we currently have 3,400 people that are paying the $10, that's everybody, right?
Yeah, and that's people that live that work in town too that are paying. They're paying the $10.
So everyone that either works in town or works elsewhere pays a $10 fee right now.
But it doesn't go, the $10 doesn't go to us, right?
Yeah. No, the 10
does. The 10 does, okay.
But another large percentage probably goes elsewhere.
Right.
But I guess what I'm saying is there a way for us to find out roughly how many people are already paying that elsewhere? Because
well, if
that's,
you take the 34,000
right.
divided by 10 is 3,400. I thought it was 340.
But Angie,
that's how many people are currently paying it here. Does that mean that they're paying it elsewhere? Definitely, if they're paying 10 here.
Great.
If they're paying 10 here, do they definitely pay like another 40 elsewhere?
Great. We don't collect your money because it goes to the school district you're in.
Angie, but you collect $10. Angie told us how many places it was happening. She told us last time.
There's a
big list.
I heard it on TV.
No, I know that. That's what I'm saying. So there is a very large list of the areas that it is being taken from. So,
where you get that money? Or
no.
Only where you
not
work.
The local service tax. Not the local.
Right. The local service tax is only the people that work in Bristol, right?
Mm-hmm. All right.
Greg is paying the local service tax where he's
right.
works. They keep
it. They keep
it. They keep it.
We institute.
We don't get it.
That money would come here.
If we institute it, that money comes here.
Correct.
Now, if we institute our own Local service tax. The money that I am currently paying to Lower Moreland School District would come here.
Right.
And I guess what I'm saying is, if that's a large percentage of people in Bristol are already doing that, then why am I continuing to give my money to Huntington Valley?
Right.
When I could be giving my money here. Now, I do understand that if only 30% of us are doing that, then 70% of us aren't, and we are effectively raising taxes on 70% of people if we do that. So I guess what I'm saying is, can we, I don't know if there's a way to find out roughly, and I know you keep saying the 3,400.
I'm only taking the number she's using that's in our budget.
Right.
And we get $10. What I don't understand is, if you're paying it at your school, why aren't we getting your $10?
I agree.
Because we are implementing, we're getting $10.
No, you're just doing it for here, though. You're doing it for Bristol. So he works outside of Bristol, so they don't touch that $10.
They get the money.
Well, what I'm saying is, we already implemented if we're collecting the 10.
Yeah, but we're only implemented to the people that are working here. People that have jobs in Bristol, that come into Bristol and do jobs, they get hit for $10.
Okay. So do you think we should implement it?
I guess all I'm saying is, that can we find out? And if 3,400 is the number, that means that a whole lot of us, right, because we're a small town, if 3,400 of us are already paying that.
No, that's not 3,400 of us. It's 3,400 of people that are in the borough that work.
I got it. Okay, anyway.
The large majority is Lennox.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Staples.
Right.
I guess Walmart.
Right.
And all these people that work.
Right. So what's the difference? And I'm sorry if I'm ignorant here, but I think it's important.
All the teachers that live here.
Right. And I think it's an important distinction to make. I don't want to see people like myself and Tony and Lorraine continue, you know, we all work at a different school district.
Yeah.
I don't want to see us continue to pay our school districts when we could be paying Bristol. That's what I'm saying.
Then you work out of town, right?
We could worry about who it's going to affect. Because if everybody's working, and we implement this, we're going to collect $52 instead of $10.
Right.
And if you make under $12,000 a year, you get your money back.
Yeah, but...
So even if you, for anybody on low income, that doesn't make a lot of money, if they got to pay, and then there's a form to fill out, and you get your $52 back, you will for anything.
But Mr. Dillon, correct me if I'm wrong. I agree. But Mr. Dillon, correct me if I'm wrong. That $52 that we would be collecting may not be a new tax for a lot of people. It's just moving it. It's moving it from, so my...
It can be.
It's moving my 52 from Lower Moreland to Bristol. Right?
Correct.
And that, I mean, for me, that makes
I feel
too
that
much
way. I feel that way, too. I can't see Pensbury getting my money.
So if we had to go to it, are you in favor of it?
I'm not sure. I want to know numbers. Right. I want to know figures.
Yeah, I'd like a little more information on who.
Yeah, I would like to know actually the same thing. I would like to know how many people it affects.
But how do we get these numbers?
And how much money would it generate? I mean, if it's not going to make it a big difference.
Yeah, if it's a big... What is it?
And that will bring the number from 596,680. It'll bring it down to $453,880.
Not the answer.
What is it again? Tell me your figure.
It drops you 2 mils. It puts 2 mils in our favor, which we started at 726,680. Mm-hmm. Ralph had cut some things with the manager, 130. That brought us down to 596,680. With that tax, you're talking about the head tax, that would bring out the bottom dollar to $453,880.
I think
that's a big chunk.
Is there somebody that could come here and explain this to us, or we're guaranteed what we're talking about?
It's almost $500,000 you're talking about.
No.
Oh, he's saying a different number. Okay.
I'm saying is that's what we're chipping away at.
Okay. All right.
All right, so let's put that on a side right now. Let me get my scratch paper.
You want me to hold that number? And
yeah, what is it, Pat?
Okay.
It's 155.
It dropped 130, and you dropped it down to 596,680.
Everything.
And then with the 142 and change, it drops it down to a figure of 453,880.
Okay.
888?
$453,880.
It needs to be researched properly, it needs to be, not saying that you didn't do it.
So right now, it's 142.
Just saying that somebody needs to really...
Right now, the 142...
Somebody needs to really tell us, like what, like you guys were saying, if you're paying it already out there, it should come to Bristol, but we need to make sure that's how it works.
All right, so we're working with 453, 880, but 142's in question.
If that was implemented.
Can we get a full report, Angie, by next week on this service tax? Exactly how it works, look what the projections are we're gonna collect. Bottom line, I know there's, we gotta pay people to collect the money and all.
Well, that's right too, I forgot about that. Gotta pay some...
Somebody wanna explain it right now?
I think somebody can do it, right? Well, the person that's doing it now will continue to do it. What about the person that's taking the $10 now, when they take the...
The rest of it just goes from, that's why they know how much money they're gonna get, because they're already collecting this 10, and they're just gonna add $42 to it, and that's how, they kinda know how much money's there already.
I think what the manager...
Pay in place.
I think what the manager and Angie is saying is, there's really no way to know...
Okay.
Who it's going to affect.
Know what it's gonna do.
So we either gotta implement it with the understanding that it's gonna create at least $140,000, $150,000, or we're not gonna implement it.
What kind of decisions are we planning on making tonight? We're just starting this conversation a little bit further, right?
Well, we're trying to get this budget, because all the other budgets really...
Yeah.
Are immaterial.
Right.
Besides this budget.
Right.
So I'm just gonna...
Well, this would be another tax for people, I'm not sure if I want, unless it's a big substantial amount of money that we'll be bringing in.
Basically, it's affecting people that work, it's not affecting anybody that doesn't work.
I get it.
Or seniors that are home, you know, trying to get by.
Okay.
So it's not, it's something our council's gotta make a decision on.
I don't think I like it.
All right, let's get into this police budget. Does anybody have anything on anything besides the police budget? Any suggestions? Okay, nobody.
One question, Ralph. On the pensions, on the police, which we'll get into, do we have a pension fund manager? Or something?
On the police pension or all the pensions?
All the pensions, uniform, non-uniform?
Yes.
Yes. And who is that?
They come in and update, Stiefel Nicholas. They come in and update us at least 2-3 times a year. The guys that stood here, the little guy and the bald-headed guy.
All right, I remember.
Okay. I wanna really understand this police budget.
Chief, you got a budget in front of you?
Yes.
Who came up with this budget? I know you and the mayor worked on it.
But...
I just don't understand where these numbers came from. I mean, you've been here a long time, and Pat's been here 16 years and a year as the mayor. I mean, this is like unacceptable as far as I'm concerned. And I don't want this, anybody take this the wrong way.
I mean...
I looked at this budget, when we did our budget in 14, we ended up with a budget number of 2738062. I want you to follow me on this and everybody else.
Yes, see it. What page are you on?
I'm on page six of nine.
Okay, that's why I can't find it.
At 214 budget.
Okay.
Okay.
When we did our budget, we ended up with 2738062. Right?
Right.
In that budget, if you look at the bottom line, additional police requests was council adding $160,000 to that budget, which we said we did not want to spend that money because we didn't project the interest coming in at the number that's in this budget. We were projecting like $240,000, $260,000. So we knew this 160 was gonna help us balance our budget. And we said if the interest rate does good, then, you know, all well and good, we would have a surplus going into next year. Does everybody remember that?
Uh-huh.
Okay. So What I'm doing is, I'm taking Angie's year-end estimate, which is 2637894. Stay on page 6 of 9, I'm not going to go off this page. You follow me so far?
Yeah, I was looking at the other page, but following you. I was looking at the other page, but following you, the budget from last year.
Well, just look at these bottom lines for now.
Yeah.
So, at 2637894, still that 160 should come out of there, as far as I'm concerned, which brings you down to 2477894. So we should spend, at the end of the year, because that 160 shouldn't be touched, and there's no reason to touch it, we should end up with our police budget at 2,477,894, unless some disaster, something goes totally wrong. You follow me, Pat?
Yeah, we,
okay, so you take this number of, even if it ends up at 2.5, but if you take that number, you're jumping your budget to 2,884,289. So you're adding $406,395 to the budget, which is a 17% increase to the police budget. Now, at 406,000, you're looking at almost 6 mils, 5¾ mils, just for the police. Now, here's my theory with this whole thing. Let me find my notes, because I was sitting in the car writing all this stuff. In 2011 to 12, if you look at this actual 11, actual 12, does everybody follow me?
Yes.
The budget went down by $338. In 12 to 13, the budget went up by $121,575, which was a 6% increase in the police budget. From 13 to 14, it went up $108,158, was a 1% increase to the budget. Now we're saying, let's take this budget that's been averaging, if you go back prior budgets, 3%, 4%, 1%, we want to go up 17%. What warrants, I don't understand how you could even put this budget together in front of council. Now let me say something else. Let's say this entire council tonight agrees that we want to give you guys exactly what you want. Okay? We all agree tonight. We want to give you, because you and the mayor's recommending, 2 full-timers, 1 part-timer, 2 full-time administrative clerks. We want to give you this. Both of you or the mayor or somebody sitting here, tell me where you want to get $406,395. Or how do we cut this general fund budget by 17%? Because what you got to understand is the other budgets, even if you cut them budgets, it can't be transferred here. So we can't say, well, we're going to take $25,000 out of recreation. We're going to take $25,000 out of street lighting. And we're going to move that to the general fund. We cannot do it. And if you look on page... If you look on page 9 of 9, go to page 9 of 9, and read what the bottom of this budget says. Maximum millage permitted, including 5 mils from the court, which we got last year. So that means if this entire council tonight said, you know what, we want to raise taxes, we can't. So everybody's sitting here saying, we're going to raise taxes, we are done. We cannot get any more money put into this budget. By law, we are maxed out at 35 mils. 2014 says millage. I don't understand why this is becoming an issue, because nobody can, in this floor, say we're going to vote tonight to increase taxes to give you what you want. So it's impossible to do this. So what I'm getting at is, I think that, look, we all know we need cops, and we all know we're going to sit here probably next month and we're going to hire a full-time police officer. I know I am, and I know most of council is.
But you got to understand that there's no money, and you can't take a budget from every year, 1%, 2%, 1% negative, to jump it by 17%. So you made an I don't know why this budget was even presented to us.
A lot of these numbers, too, came from the increase in medical and pension and those things I have no control
over. Right, which went up about, I looked at that, they went up about 80,000.
Like you've always said, it's a working document. And looking at
I
the
know
manpower,
that, Chief, but what I'm saying is, I'm trying to help you and the mayor out tonight by saying, if this council tonight elected to say, you know what, we want to give you this 2884289, where do we get it? Just tell me and I'll give it to you.
That I don't know.
You know what I mean, Pat?
I don't know how the revenues come in.
You want to go through my line item?
Yeah. Okay. If you look at response, let's go back to something first.
Page 5 and 9?
If you go to, I got a different paper here, and the chief could jump on. That'd be page 1 of 2, Mr.
Page 1 of 2?
Yeah. One.
We don't have that.
That's the memo. The memo.
Oh, your memo.
Yeah.
I don't have that.
Let's
the budget.
Yeah.
In the back.
In the back. I'm sorry.
And then we'll go.
Okay.
Yeah. No, it's the memo, Mr. President, right here.
Wait a minute. Let us get to it, okay?
Give
us a second. Okay.
Pat, what's it look like?
This.
Keep going.
Oh,
right here.
This one.
This is what it's
talking about. One more.
2015.
Behind it.
So yeah. 1 of 2 or 2 of 2, Pat?
It's one of 2.
One of 2.
One of 2.
Okay. All right.
You know, if you read this, basically, the first paragraph, police full-time year 2015 is the final year of our police contract.
This is the last year.
Yeah. So as a result of the new step, 13 officers are going to receive a 3.5% annual increase. One officer is going to receive a 25.5% increase. And that's all contractual, something we have no control over.
Right.
That comes out to a total of $56,500, correct, Chief?
Approximately.
Yes. Then you also have an increase in court time of 3.4%. Then the chief and I were talking about getting updated with computers in
the vehicles. Why is there an increase in court time?
This page 1 of 2 I'm looking at has mileage for a car.
Oh, contractual.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
And then one of the items that Mr. Porter or Chief Porter brought up is that there's 7 mobile data terminals that are in the vehicles that need to be updated, and they come up at between $200 to $2,500 a piece. You also only have how many officers are formally hired? We're just shooting those around. Yeah. Why don't you take over from here, Chief, and explain some more of this?
Why don't you get a microphone if you're going to sit there?
Yeah, there it is. Right.
Give Pat a mic.
No, I'm okay. I'm just talking to them. I'll get this one over here. Pat, Chief. And like I said, these are all new numbers, whatever you guys want to do.
Guys, I don't think it's what we want to do. I'm just trying to understand how we could increase a budget by 17%, which is $406,000.
The main issue is going to be, like we said, on the personnel, the police personnel, the full-time personnel. I was requesting 2 extra full-time personnels for next year and 1 additional part-time officer. That's where some of your costs will come in. The budget, the contract does prescribe 3.5% raises for everybody. There are certain areas that I've trimmed down as best as I could. The areas that are increased that I'm not going to be able to help. Our computers have to be upgraded. Good number of them are on XP, and it's cheaper just to replace some of these materials rather than have a text come in and convert everything over. But everything else, if you look at it, there's not very many increases.
No, I went through it all. That's what Pat said. Let's go through the line items.
Everything is pretty lean.
I don't know where you're going, what you're going to do.
Nothing is exorbitant.
No, I'm not saying that.
I saved us, well, not yet. The year's not over. Purchasing a new vehicle this year. Because we have a few less officers driving around this year, I figured let's try and save the money there.
You know what, Arnie, on that, you can't take that out because if you total two cars, a previous council person wanted to do that, and then we total two cars and what happened? We had to use the money, so.
No, I need one for next year. There's no.
Right.
Yeah, if you look at the mileage on some of these vehicles, they're definitely in need.
So everything is pretty lean, and actually some of the stuff I might have been too lean on because this computer number might end up come October, November next year might be exhausted. But the issue of the dollars and cents is going to be the hiring of the new officers. And
do you know what it costs, Pat, to hire a new officer full-time?
Full-time?
One officer with family, you know.
Well, you're talking the benefits and everything? Okay. You got that one number we were working on.
Yeah, I think it was a starting salary from $45,000 brought him back up to about $90,000, I believe.
Yeah. 45.5 was the number for an officer.
I'm saying when you get done with benefits.
We worked on that. What was the final number we came up with?
90.
Yeah.
And then a part-timer is about 50,000. Get all done.
Yes.
Because they're $23 an hour.
And you can use them for 8 hours or you can use them for 35.
Right.
That's the max.
I just think that, you know, the police budget is 2.8 million, I think. 2.8, almost $2.9 million for the police department. And I believe in the strongest police department that this town, because the taxpayers deserve the best protection we can. And I know right now downstairs, we don't have a personnel problem. We have a staffing problem right now. Because if we were full strength, our police department would be fine. But we're not full strength, but does anybody disagree that we don't have a...
If we were full strength, we'd be where we were maybe 3 or 4 years ago when we had that overlapping shift that went from 7 to 7.
Well, hopefully we can get to that shift. But if you look at salaries, in 2010, we had 16... Got it, Tony.
Yeah, I mean, just to jump in there, there's two schools of thought that, I mean, two ways I'm thinking is... The first part is I'm more in line for saying more part-time officers. And like, I hear the argument that I hear is that, well, we don't want to, we do a lot of training, they become the training, and then somebody else gets our officers.
Right.
To me, I don't have a problem with that, right? I don't have a problem with getting new people in here, training them. To me, the more officers that we can get in, and the cheaper for the taxpayer, I think it's better. That's just the way I feel about it. So instead of bringing in new full-time officers, right, where we're going to bring in two or three, whatever that number is, and then we have these contractual issues, right, that we're going to have to continue, you know, to keep these on, and you can't lay them off. You bring in these part-timers, you get them, they're going to do their work, they're going to get better. And yeah, we might lose them to another municipality. It'd be like a training ground for them. I don't have a problem with that. And I think that it's more cost efficient and better for the taxpayers of the borough. And we're always going to have our top of the line officers that are going to be well rounded and well schooled in the area with the people and all those things. But I think for me, I would push more. Until you know the contract issue is resolved or whatever that we come across that I would vote to put more part-time officers in versus hiring more full-time officers. That is the first part. The second part, I'm trying to think of where I was now. So we're talking about. I'll come back to it because I can't even remember. What was it?
Is it a line item?
Maybe. I'll come back to it, but, I mean, that's just my thought with the part-time officers. I know what it is. The second part is, Arnie, and I think Greg and I are in the same position as teachers, as police officers, in the sense that, you know, it's based on the taxpayers or the ones that are covering it. So what Ralph's saying is, I agree. When it comes to that boiling point, where do you get the money, right? Where do you get the money? Because you can't keep taxing these people. There's people in the North Ward that I talk to, constituents that I talk to, they're in row homes and they're in, you know, twins, and they're paying $5,200 in taxes. There's only so much before it explodes. And we're at that bubble. We have to be more creative. I don't know what that is, but we have to be more creative in figuring out the balance of safety for the residents and the economics for the people in there, in the borough to pay for it. And I think that's where we're at. I mean, we're talking about making it $3 million, we can only raise taxes in the borough. If we got 100% of our taxes, we can only bring in like $2.5 million. So we can't even cover the police department's budget with our tax base. So I think that that's where we're at in this point, and I think that we definitely have to look at it, you know, line for line. And the other question I have is, how effective are in helping the police department would be like town watches? Because it's like a mixed bag. I hear good things and I hear bad things.
No, I don't think that would assist us in any way as far as...
I think it's more of a hindrance than a help.
But I think I would have felt remiss if I didn't come in here asking for full-time officers. The only other plan would be, if I don't get full-time officers, is part-time officers. That's mm-hmm. that's the only other way. We need
right.
more boots on the ground. We got to have it.
Let me just say something. We had 3 part-time officers, outstanding officers. We lost 2 the other police departments. We still have 1. I think we made a commitment 10 years ago to strengthen this police department with full-time officers, because they stay here, they're not going to leave, because it takes you 3 to 4 months to train somebody. So we're paying somebody to ride shotgun until they learn. Then after they learn, we may get lucky and keep them for 6 months to a year, and then they go off to Ben Salem or to another police department. So I always believe full-time is the best way to go, because you have an officer that's going to stay here and make a commitment to this town. I mean, that's just my opinion. It costs you a little bit more. I'm sure you could put 2 part-timers versus 1 full-timer. There's no question. But I said earlier in my statement, I don't think we have a personnel problem downstairs. I think we have a staffing problem because of the guys that are out. So, I mean, I think you got to be realistic, and let's work on this number.
Let's get back to some numbers.
Let me just see what you're doing.
Yeah, I mean, along the same lines, Ralph, I guess we can't have it both ways. I mean, in the perfect world, everybody would want full-time officers. But the reality is, we are at the max, like you said. There's no room. People think that, yeah, we're going to increase taxes, or you have to. There's no room to increase that. You can't do it. So the only other option is we have to find ways to cut. And as hard as it is, and I've said the same thing last year, we had the same discussions. Ralph, the things that you were able to cut on the first page and the third page are things that I brought up last year. It's the same types of things. And it is difficult. We have to do the same thing. It's only, the pot is only this big. You can only get so much into it. It's overflowing. You can't do anymore. You have to cut back. You got to take some stuff out of it.
There's nothing to take out.
Let's. Can we go through some hard
numbers? Nothing to take out, though.
Can we go through some hard numbers real quick?
Yeah.
Okay. Year-end estimate. Year-end estimate. Okay?
Where do you want to go?
All right.
Okay.
What page?
Well, I'm using my budget. It would be.
I think it's this one. It's looking like it.
You're looking at the year-end estimate?
Yeah. Estimate request? Yeah, we got it.
Okay. Now, you look at the 2014 year-end estimate.
And I don't know, where are we?
For 2014.
Wait a second.
8, 6, and 9?
I'm working on a different page.
Okay.
Okay. Tell me when you're there.
It looks like this.
It's part of that, these.
There it is.
Okay. It says $1,186,287.
Right.
Okay, now, contractual, you get the $56,500. You add that to that number, because you can't do nothing about that contract. That brings the number up to $1,242,787. Now, in our budget, the difference between the 2015 estimated request of $133,682, that's just for account 410-100-01, is only $90,895.
So you're saying you're...
So basically, I mean, let's... Where do you guys want to work?
So you're saying, Pat, you're saying you're only requesting $90,000 additionally, considering that the other things are fixed costs.
I want the chief to jump in here. Am I correct in it?
I wasn't...
I'm not even following.
Okay.
Too well.
Okay.
What line number was
it? You have to add the $56,000 into that 2014 budget to see where we're at for 2015.
Okay.
Say this again, Pat.
In order to really put the numbers down, you have to add that contractual number in to the police full-time.
Well, the 2015 estimate, is it different than what's on our budget?
1,333,500.
This here, Arnie, answer me a question. This, is that this?
I don't know what.
The request is the same as the budget.
This sheet of paper, yes. We don't need it, right?
No, it's
because it's the same thing that's here, isn't it?
It is.
Well, there's some changes in my original one that I got that Angie updated.
No, it's
updated.
The same.
And this column is the same, right?
Right.
133.91.
Those are the same.
They put in their request in the budget.
Contractual money.
So he thinks he can go lower? So they're on the next page.
Thousand off of this?
No. When you add to the 2,000 actual, you're $90,895 short. So now I'm going to turn this over to Mr. Porter. He made some adjustments today.
So you're sure?
All right, guys.
We're over.
I'm confused.
All right, we're getting confused. Who's talking, Arnie? You or Pat?
Me, Arnie.
I still didn't follow them. I'm sorry.
I don't know what the 90,000, what we're talking about.
52 or 56.5 to this, and when I subtract it from the estimate, this is the number we come up with.
I don't know how that would relate to that.
Okay, good. You can take over, and I'll be with you.
Pat, if you look at this 2014 year-end estimate.
Go ahead.
We're estimating it's going to be $1,186,287.
Mm-hmm.
So you're jumping, and you subtract them two numbers, 133,682, 1,186,287.
I just want to make sure I'm right.
It should be about right. 140,000.
147,395.
So it's $147,000 more that you're going up.
But 56.5 is contractual money.
So if you take 56.5 off of that,
okay.
Then you
just
90,
give me 1 minute.
No, I was going to help Pat out.
So you're saying
90,000
over.
So you got an extra 90,000.
Okay.
Now let's start working.
Now we're talking.
So are you saying take the 90,000?
No. Let's start working from this.
The 90,000 would equal 2 full-time officers.
That's where you're at.
Before benefits.
Well, you can't do that.
That's where we got last year. We end up putting... All right, Tony, do you have something? Yeah, your hand up.
No, I was going to say this. I was trying to help Pat out, because I understood what Pat was doing.
Oh, good.
You know what I mean? But
no, because, I mean, everybody's saying we're jumping all this millage. I know that the insurance is going to be high.
But what I'm saying is...
Numbers here.
All I'm saying is, before we get out of hand, if you just add, it's not what we're saying, there's $406,395 more in 2015 budget versus 2014 year-end estimate, which is 17% more money. That's all I'm saying. Tell me what you want to cut, or if you don't want to cut, we'll figure a way to either implement something to get this money, because there's no more tax money to be had. So the bubble's not bursting. You know, if everybody's realistic, we could balance this budget very, very simply. I mean, it could be simple to balance this budget, but everybody's got to be on board saying, you know, what do we really need here?
Can you make...
I mean, does the service tax help? Sure, it brings $100,000+ into the general fund. But we can't increase the budget by $406,000. I mean, if you say to us tonight, I need a full-time officer, then let's work from that number. I mean, what is one guy, two guys, or three guys going to do for this force tomorrow that's not going to benefit down the road if everybody comes back? Now, if you said we lost two guys, then we need to do something. I was getting at something earlier. In 2010, we had 16 police officers, right? Our payroll for the cops, no overtime or nothing, could have been overtime, was $1,297,664 for 16 cops. In 11, we had 15 cops. It was $1,321,39. In 12, we had 14 cops. We were down two. And everybody said we never replaced the cops that we lost. The budget for two less cops in 12 was $1,316,426. For the same cops in 13 was $1,415,589. In 14, the budget for the same amount of cops was, let me find that, I'm just trying to add some numbers. It's got to be at least $1,000,006. At least $1,000,006. So if we had the 16 cops, that $1,000,006 may have been $2 million. So even though we have less cops, the salaries go up every year. Benefits, year. Everything goes up.
Every year, 3%, and then right. Some officers got those huge raises.
Well, because of the contract. But what I'm saying is they all wanted to be equal, and we negotiated a contract that we thought was a good deal for everybody. So when they say we never replaced what we had, I understand we didn't replace them, but the salary constantly is going up.
Contractually, so, nothing that
contractually.
Could have been done.
Now, next year, the contract's up. And I'm going to, you know, I know Tony said he wanted to be on. I'm going to put him and Dave and whoever on this negotiate the contract. Let's see what they come up with. They want to take the no layoff clause out or whatever. I'll, you know.
If we're looking to hire one this year or the beginning of next year, and then we're not going to be able to handle financially two full-timers, then again, the alternative is part-time. We need more people.
We definitely need more people on the street. You see what's going on. I don't want to put a fear factor in here. We need to put police officers on the
is
street.
Is overtime impacting us tremendously?
No.
We a lot of overtime, but it's taking out of the monies that we would have spent for a full-timer that I asked for this year, which we didn't get, and three part-timers, which we only worked with one all year. Plus, we have an officer who has been out since January, so that salary hasn't been paid for 10 months.
How does that work, Marty? So he's out since January, then you don't pay at all?
Right. No salary. He's, because he's out sick, a non-duty related injury.
So does your budget include?
I'll do whatever you want.
Does your budget include the current officers who are on disability?
Yes.
So it includes what we are or what they're being paid?
Yes.
In disability.
Yes.
Which is less than a full-time salary, right? Are they getting full salary while they're on disability?
Yes.
Okay. So if and when they come back, that's not going to skew this budget in any way.
No.
Their insurance, though, they're going to get it through.
Right. So that's what I'm saying. So they're getting paid short-term or full-term disability, long-term disability, right?
Well, one's on disability, one's on heart and lungs.
Right. Sure. No, and I'm not questioning that. I'm saying, do we pay them? Is it coming out of our pocket right now to pay that?
That's through insurance company and the heart and lungs.
Good, right. And it's well-earned and well-deserved. I guess my question is, though, if and when they return, hopefully they do for their sake, we then do incur their salary back.
Correct.
Is that in here?
Yes. The salaries are in here.
Okay.
Still in here. Okay.
A lot of this stuff, Greg, you know, is contractual. I mean,
sure.
We could do it by line item. I have no problem. But there is some things we're not going to be able to get away with. We definitely need a vehicle. I don't know if you've seen the report on the mileage on the vehicles. We got one that's got 92,700 miles on it. And Mrs. Trunell had brought up something. She's right. We are chewing up some of our, like, the overtime is being chewed up with the gentleman who lost his wages in January, with the part-timers that we lost, that we allotted for, and that's where the money's going.
Again, I mean, I just want to throw out there that we did lose some part-timers.
Yes, in January we lost two.
Well, we lost part-timers because we didn't hire full-timers.
Exactly.
Just saying.
Exactly.
Yep. And they would have been valuable assets because they knew the town, they were from the town, and they've gone on to become great cops where they're at, the police officers. Our police force is in need right now, and no one could say it more than the residents of this town. I'm up here fighting for police. So you guys want to go in here and gut this budget? We'll try to do the best we can.
We don't want to cut it. We're just figuring, where do you get the money?
Let's go through it.
Because there's no tax money. For you to get money, for us to get money to fund this,
right,
we can't get it from taxes. So we either got to get it through a local service tax or through an earned income tax. There's not another pot to go to.
I understand that, Mr. DeGiuseppe.
That's what I'm saying. It isn't that we don't want to fund it.
Right.
We just, somebody needs to tell me how to fund
it. $750,000 just in contractual income.
Okay, but it's there. We can't.
And then we still don't know what the court costs are going to cost us. That might bring it to them, though.
Is there any way that, and we really shouldn't talk about this in public, but is there any way that we could talk later about scheduling issues, like, sure, maybe?
Absolutely, and we have an open, Joe Moores, myself, and the chief, when we met. Mr. Moores and the chief knows if we need to do something, even though we're going to fine.
Okay.
So
what are the implications of, on this budget as it is written in your request? You request two full-time officers, one part-time, two full-time administrative clerks.
Yeah, what is that all about?
What are the implications if we were to go with, I don't know, three part-timers? What are the implications on the budget?
Tremendous savings.
It's a good savings, number one, but let's play the devil's advocate here, okay?
Sure.
You got one part-timer that we still have. He's been here for 5-6 years. Let's take it another step. When me and the chief met this week, or late last week, hiring a full-timer, we went through all the process. We had him suited up, had him fitted for Kevlar. He didn't even last 2 hours.
We were discussing how some part-timers, we lost one after one day, some after a couple weeks, some after a few months.
So,
and some after a couple years, too, though, right?
Yeah. We have to find those guys.
I mean, the thing about it is, we're talking about is a perfect world, right? But we're not in a perfect world. We have to be creative.
Absolutely.
And when I'm saying, the way I feel is, you have part-timers that come in, even if it's like a revolving door. We got part-timers coming in, we train them, whatever. They're still in the street, they're doing their job, they're making the residents feel safe, comfortable in their houses. Now, as they get better, they move on. We got another group. There's always, just like teachers, there's always going to be ones coming up ready. They need training. They need to go they need to go get their feet wet and learn somewhere. If this happens to be the training ground, I'm okay with that. The idea of somebody that has been doing it, and we're going to continue hiring full time just because of the stigma that, you know, they've been doing it a long time, and we're going to lose those good officers. They're not going to be full. We can't worry about that. We have to worry about two things. Number one, the safety of the residents, and number two, the wallet of the residents.
Can I just interject at this point?
Sure.
And you know, it's nice to talk about a perfect world, and I like the rhetoric, but do you disagree that we do need a full-time police officer? And the next question is, if we don't have many part-timers now, where do we get them? Do we have a whole pool, Arnie and Pat, of part-timers that we can pull from? Is there a lot of part-timers that would be out there that are available to us?
Usually ebb and flow.
Here's my theory. It's like you're a teacher.
Mm-hmm. He is a teacher, not like
you're teaching.
Teacher.
You're teaching a class, and then kids in the middle of the year have to get another teacher.
Mm-hmm.
Although that curriculum's probably going to stay the same, they're going to try. Mm-hmm. It's not the same of having stability in the classroom or in the police department. I think, and Pat's been here for 16 years. You can't tell me that having a full-time department isn't better than a part-time department.
Listen,
we took over, Tony. There were 8 cops on this force, mm-hmm. and 6 part-timers. They were only reacting to calls. They weren't being proactive. And right now, we're probably doing the same thing. We're reacting. But again, it's a staffing issue, not a personnel issue. And
what do you mean by that?
Have the manpower. We just, they're hurt right now.
Right, but then we're speaking the same language, because what I'm talking about is, we're talking about a contractual issue now, right? So, like you said, and it's the rhetoric of if it was a perfect world. A perfect world, yeah, we would like to have. I feel the same way. Do I think that a full-time officer is going to be better than a part-time officer if we keep them and if we can pay them? Absolutely. The problem is, we don't have the money to do it. And then
I think we do, but we can't afford what they're putting out there right now. We can't afford a full-time secretary, and all these other. We can't increase the budget by $406,000.
Well, then we're on the same
page. I'm not saying we can't increase the police. Let me just throw something out there for you and the mayor. Right now we're, and tell me if I'm wrong, I don't know, Pat, the last number we had on the table was 453-880. The number we were sure.
You mean on the general budget, the overall, $453,880, and I believe it's something.
That's where we're at right now.
Let me make a suggestion.
That's if the
142
goes.
That's if we implemented the tax.
If you guys implement that tax, you're down to 453,880.
Okay. Let's use that number for now.
I don't like it.
If I said to you and the mayor, we're going to give you an additional $175,000, okay? That takes $231,395 off of this deficit, which now brings it down to $222,485. That's using this 140-some thousand with the service tax. So we're trying to close this gap. Out of the 175,000, I think 80 or 90 of it is contractual, right? So that's leaving you close to 95,000. So you know where I'm going with this,
mm-hmm.
for you guys to make a decision on how we're going to hire somebody.
Try to make this work.
So
instead of taking the whole 406, I'm trying to work somewhere and split this difference with you, and say, for now, let's give you 175. That may not be the right number, I don't know, maybe you're going to need more, but try to work within the 175, I think it's like 6%. What is 170, Angie? We give them 175,000 on the 2477894.
So can I just say, I'm just really confused now. So when you're talking about the 175,000, that's what they're asking for, they wouldn't get, and they would get 175,000 in lieu of?
Instead of, right.
Yes, then, what?
Well, you throw the one...
Instead of the 2884289.
Okay.
They would end up with, let me give you this number.
Oh, just subtract out the one...
No, 2477894 and 175. They would end up with...
You get that, Mr. DiGiuseppe, there's one issue I want to bring up about that.
You guys would end up with 2,652,894. Say 2.27, if you want to round it off. That's cutting your budget by 184,000.
And that makes us, Ralph, real quick, give us the figure, and that makes us shy by 222?
Cuts down to 222,485.
Okay.
Okay, so out of that 175, so everybody knows this before they vote on this budget.
We ain't voting until December.
Right, but just so you know, from now, the October 25th or 26th or 7th, whatever it is, that 175 you're throwing at us, that brings us down, after contractual money, down to 118,500 bucks, okay, not counting the insurance and the pension. Then you got $35,000 for a car, if you...
No, you're looking at it wrong, Clark. We're taking your 2,884,289 that you're requesting.
Okay.
And we're taking 231 off of that. Am I right, Angie? The numbers are right? So we're still giving you, in this number, you have two full-timers, you have all these numbers that are in there.
Okay.
Arnie, you understand?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know where you're going with this. I'm looking at it different angle.
I'm not going line item with you.
Okay.
I'm giving you a total budget to say, try to make this work with an additional 175.
Okay.
Because your contractual numbers are in the estimated budget for 15.
I'm just looking at, I'm just trying to figure out, at the end of the day...
So, Ralph...
And I put a new vehicle, me and Mr., the chief here, Mr. Porter, can we put a new chief, and can we put people on, behind these wheels to give the safety of this town? That's what I'm looking for, from this town.
I'm not cutting your cars.
Just give us more money.
I'm giving you more money than you need.
We like that.
I'm trying to help.
Thank you.
I'm not trying to hurt anybody here. All I'm saying is, we can't get this money elsewhere. So in your contractual numbers, you guys ended up with 2,884,289. What I'm trying to say is, let's take 221 off of that, 231 off of that, and see if you can make it work with 175.
That number includes...
Includes all the stuff they submitted.
It includes their contractual obligations.
For 2015, they're saying they need $1,333,682.
Right.
I'm not taking it off of any line item.
Right.
I'm just taking the bottom number and saying...
Right.
We're going to cut that budget by $231,495. Now, will it work, Greg? I don't know.
I hear you.
I mean, they might come back and say, there's no way we could do it, it's impossible.
So instead of 400 some odd thousand to work with, including the contractual obligations, they have 200 and some odd thousand to work with.
Right.
And we're saying, take this 200 some thousand dollars and come back to us.
175.
Round it to 2.7.
Here's what everybody's got to understand, the year-end estimate that Angie has on our budget is 2,637,894, on page 6 of 9. Right?
Yep.
but it really should be, because that 160 should come out.
Right.
It really should be 2477894. That should be the right number for the police, but we will come in on, right around that number at the end of the year.
That's if we don't hire anyone before the end of this calendar year. Right?
That's not going to change for a month or two by a lot of money.
Well, I'm saying that 160 is...
That 160, when, last year, when we did the budget, there was a problem with the budget. Arnie didn't add in their, he just added in salaries.
Secretary salary.
Salaries and things like that. So we had to put that in if we would have hired these people, and if we would have hired a police officer, and if we would have did everything they wanted.
Right.
He was short to do that.
Okay.
So we said, we'll give you what you want, but just understand, if we don't hit the interest mark on the 24 million, you do not spend this money without council's approval, which they didn't. So if you look at the budget right now, I don't foresee it coming in over 2.5.
Got you.
Which should be good. It should be exactly where we want to be.
Right.
Because if you look at the budget number for 14, it was 2738062.
Right.
If you take that 160 off, it's 2578062.
Right.
So coming in under budget at 2.5, 2.48, 2.49 is doing good.
Where we're at.
Plus, don't forget, we didn't pay salaries.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are cops that are out. So that's why I'm concerned for 15. So if, going through this whole thing, if we down to 222485, and that's counting the, what did we put in, 140 for the...
143, yeah.
For the tax, what was that, 140?
143, I keep saying, I can't hear me. 143.
The service tax.
Yeah.
Now we got to figure how to get this 222485 down. And I said earlier to you, you can't take it from another budget. So don't even think about, well, let's try to cut here, let's try it. That's immaterial.
All right, then I guess the next question is, I have the feeling I might be wrong. You got something in your pocket.
No, I don't. I absolutely...
No, I remember last year, we got money from the sewer department.
The only thing we can do is, and it's not the way to balance a budget, is to look at our income, and are we going to do these projects on the river? Are we going to do stocks this year? That's going to change this budget dramatically.
How do we balance the budget now based on projections for next year?
Well, it's a number you got to put in the budget.
Oh, yeah, all right, just plug it in?
No, you plug it in. If it don't work, then we all got to understand tonight is, come next year, if you can't make payroll...
But I mean, I feel...
We have to go get money somewhere else.
I feel very confident about the stock, only because of the amount of money this man's put out already. I mean, tearing down that building was not cheap.
I mean, I remember somebody sitting here said, don't renovate Borough Hall until they sell the houses at Riverfront North. So we would still be washing our hands at the water fountain. So if we would have listened to him.
Well, he's not here anymore.
Thanks.
Hey, you know, to make assumptions on the revenue side is one thing, but, you know, I don't know, I mean, you're trying to be cautious and say, are we going to get this money? I mean, it's...
Like I said, it's not a big gamble, though. It's not a real...
It's $222,000 gamble, so a quarter of $1 million almost.
All right, but if you talk about transfer tax, let's just say for 8 units at $500,000 apiece.
As many dollars. That whole...
Jimmy trying to get out.
No. Hey, can we talk about...
Does anybody in the public want to comment on anything? Go to the podium.
Can you tell for the local service taxes?
Local service taxes, it's basically a head tax, where if you work in the borough, you would pay, they would take $52 a year out of your check, and we would collect 42 of that, and the school district would get 10.
We also need to look at our yearly inspections, and we start raising them to go back to yearly inspections.
we should be able to generate some money there.
But this price for the inspection stays the same.
But you need to understand something, you can't profit off an inspection.
I know, we need to change a lot of that too, so that we can have some of these people that don't care.
Right, but we can't use the inspection department for a source.
I know, Ralph, I'm looking for anybody.
I think using the yearly inspection helps the chief and the police officers out greatly because they get an idea through John Miller, who's the newcomers on the block. We got a better update.
Every unit has to be registered, their names are on file.
We pay for that every year.
And Arnie gets a copy of everything that goes on, am I correct?
I have access to it.
I'll get back to your question. That's what it is. And a earned income tax is, it's 1% of your income. So if you made $100,000 for the year, the borough would receive $1,000.
Earned
income tax.
Earned.
And if the school board elects, they would take half of that. So we would get 500, the school board would get 500.
No.
Yeah, I don't.
Let's get Michi up there.
Does earned income tax touch pensions or retirement?
Only what you earn. Whatever your pay is, you pay 1% of. Am I right?
That's correct.
And that's your take home pay? Right, now you're gross.
It's gross, 1% on your gross.
Earned, 1% of what you earn. So if you earn $1,000 in a week, the borough gets $10.
Mr. DiGiuseppe, at this point then, you went, or we went from 726,680 down to 222,485 in tonight's meeting, correct?
Right.
If we're all in agreement, I mean, I don't know, we're just talking tonight. We're going to come back here again and talk about this.
So that's where we're at.
If we can get to that number, I still don't know how we're going to close this gap unless we add revenue to our budget, because I don't foresee anywhere in this budget we could cut $222,000 out of it. You can go through every line item, you can go through anything you want. There is not that much money to cut. Weechi.
Yes, Ralph.
Jose Acevedo, North Ward. Last year when Dave brought up the local service tax, I stood up here and mentioned the earned income tax. And at that time I mentioned that 83% of municipalities in the state of Pennsylvania have this tax. Angie, at the last meeting, I think, Lorraine, you asked her to read off the name, but she kept going on and on and on and on. So sort of like you guys are talking about the $10 bringing it back into the borough. Well, if you work in Newtown, Bristol Township, Middletown, all these towns, you're paying that tax. So you want that back into Bristol instead of paying it to Middletown, Newtown, Bristol Township. You live in Bristol, you work in Bristol Township, you pay that 1%. So if you gross, I think the median average income for a Bristolian is like $43,000. So you're looking at $430 for the year per worker. So basically, it'll be a new tax on the people who work in Bristol who don't pay that 1%. The people who work out of town and pay that already, you're paying it to where you're working in that town. So, and I think the projections, I think Jim had a projection of $750,000 for the year 15.
But then the school will get half of that.
So you're looking at $375,000, which would take care of your $200+. So as Dave spoke last year, earlier this year, and me too, the thing is we're trying to keep this off of the senior citizens. We're the workers. We're the ones who make the money. If they're taking our 1% out of our paychecks, and make sure it comes to Bristol, that's all I have to say. So if Jim's projections are correct, takes care of the 200, and if the school board takes half, you still have a little bit more to do all the things.
Question based on Jose's statements, because maybe we've been talking about so many things. From what you're saying, is it accurate, Jim, that on the earned income as well? Because we were talking about something else with the service tax. Now, so Jose is saying that the earned income tax, so again, using my job as an example, right now I pay 1% to my municipality that I work in,
That will come to Bristol.
If we instituted it, I would no longer pay that 1% where I work, I would only pay that 1% here, is that accurate?
That's correct.
And that goes for anybody who lives in Bristol and works Newtown, Bristol Township.
So the only people that would be getting a double whammy, I guess, are people that actually work in Bristol Borough.
Correct.
And live in Bristol Borough.
Correct. As I understand it, yep, that'd be it.
Yeah, if you work out of town that we don't have one, you pay.
You pay.
If they have one in Ben Salem, you're paying Ben Salem 1%.
Correct.
If the borough has it, you will pay the borough.
And Jose, not that I don't trust you at all, I know you're very well informed. I would like us to get a professional up here to just explain clearly to us. Again, I trust that you know your stuff.
No, I don't.
But before we vote on such a thing, I would like a trained professional to be in here to say.
I said to Jim earlier, I'd like to get somebody up here to explain boat taxes.
Yes, I would.
Somebody that doesn't cost a lot of money for one night.
So I have.
Thanks, Jose.
Maybe somebody will come in and do it for nothing.
Mr. Bixler.
Are we going to call the PR tax? I'm kidding, Dave, relax, it was a joke.
The roofer's tax.
You can.
I'm kidding.
No.
I'm kidding.
Good evening, Ken Bixler, 300 Block Cleveland Street. What Jose was saying about the EIT is correct, but, well, first of all, and Greg made a good point, it would be nice to know how many people are already paying it and let the money revert back to the borough. That would be wonderful, and it would be nice to have that breakdown if we can find out, and how many people are going to get it that aren't paying it and will have to start. Like I said, if you make $80,000 a year, or if that's your household income, combined or single, you know, that's $800 a year on top of what you're already paying. But now I know for Bristol Township's EIT is 0.5%. So if Bristol Borough, if you work in Bristol Township and you live in Bristol Borough, I'm just saying, like, so it'll go up. You might be paying 0.5% now, but it'll go up. You know, you're going to see that other 0.5% go up. But anyhow, that's not why I came up here to talk about those and all. But I saw the advertisement of the two new taxes last week in the Courier. I saw them in the Courier.
Say this again, I'm sorry.
Okay, that's okay. I saw the advertisements for the EIT,
right,
and the service tax that will be voted on the 24th of next month, right? Last year, you raised taxes almost 7 mils, which is, you know, about $110, $115 for the average homeowner in Bristol. You're projecting a shortfall as well this year, and I'm hearing some good things tonight, and pretty much everybody's on the same consensus that a big issue is the contractual agreements you have with uniform, non-uniform, pensions, health care, sick, you know, whatever. No layoff clauses. I think that's our biggest problem, or part of the money woes, are these contractual agreements with uniform and non-uniform employees. I cut a lot of stuff out, so I'm not going to say all this, don't worry. All right, I realize there are things in the budget. Now, some of this is, like, it's all retrospect. You know, it's not all, I'm pointing some things out because I don't want to see history repeat itself. Some are wondering how did we get to this point? You're at the point where you can't raise millage anymore. You're going to look for other sources. How do we get to this point?
Very simple, but I'll tell you in a minute.
Okay. All right. I have a good notion how you got to this point. I know there's things in the budget that go up and pretty substantially every year that they're out of control and beyond anybody's control, as far as like for health care for employees. But anyhow, I just want to say something. I know a lot of people, or some people, aren't going to like this, what I'm going to say, but I think it needs to be said in retrospect to this council and for future council members. Bristol Borough is among the poorest, or the poorest municipality in the county, in terms of income and real estate values. And yet we're among the highest in paid salaries and benefits for our municipal workers, our secretaries, our police officers, and our school teachers. Now, I know you're not, that's a different entity, but why is that?
I'm not what?
I said school teachers aren't part of this entity, I know that, but I'm just saying, why is that? Do you know? Why are we one of the poorest municipalities, but we have, and I'll argue up and down with anybody, we are among the highest paid for our employees in the county. I've seen Lower Makefield, I've seen Bristol Township, I've seen Bristol Borough, you know, so anyhow, go ahead, answer.
What you have to understand is that if you sat here tomorrow, you start with this base salary, $25 an hour, whatever it is, $15 an hour. Now, from that salary, it's like any teacher sitting here or anybody else. They never take a pay cut, never. You can't tell me one, the Chamonix School District, Ben Salem School District, you took pay cuts. Maybe freezes.
No, we took a pay cut our last contract.
And how much do you get prior to that?
It was just the difference of the package for your, you know,
insurance.
With the raise, yeah, so you took a pay cut.
Well, because you paid for more percentage.
Yeah, and I'm not complaining. All I'm saying is it's going, I'm in the same boat. So
what I'm saying, Mr. Bixler, is you start with a base. When you sit down and negotiate a contract, you're trying to negotiate the best deal you can for the taxpayers.
I would hope so. Okay.
So we didn't start at $5 an hour. We didn't start at $10 an hour. We didn't start at $15 an hour. When we started negotiating these contracts, salaries were already way over what we thought they would be. So now we have to negotiate from there. There has never been an arbitration ruling against the police department ever in Bristol Borough. So now you got to understand one thing. You're going to go into negotiations, and Tony's going to experience it next year, and Dave and whoever else wants to be on this committee. They don't need to negotiate with you to go backwards, because they know if they go to arbitration, they're not going to lose in arbitration. So you need to negotiate the best deal you can for the borough. So when you're talking 1%, 3%, over a five-year contract, it's not a bad contract. It's just that we started with a base salary that was already escalated.
Inflated, right.
Well, you want to call it inflated, but don't forget, the borough workers, there's only six or seven guys down there. So when you say they're overpaid, they maintain this entire town. Okay, that's number one. Other departments have a lot of guys out there. Our police department worked here 9 years without a contract. 9 years. We came in, we settled the contract, and they made a commitment to this borough that they were going to clean up this town, which they did. This is an unbelievable year with cops being out. If somebody could predict that, I would tell them, give me a number for tomorrow to play. But you can't sit here and say our people are overpaid, and this council and previous councils should go in and try to do. There's nothing you're going to do.
There has to be something you can do.
You or anybody else thinks that you're going to come in next year's contract with the police department and you're going to cut a deal that they're not going to get a pay increase, I like to see who's going to negotiate that deal.
Can I say one thing, Mr. Bixler? Times are tough everywhere, and so this is an issue I think that a lot of municipalities are running into, and it's exceptional for us because of our size. It makes it a lot harder, I think, because of the revenue that we have. But, I commend the borough workers and those of us that negotiated and agreed to, and I think there are some solutions. I don't think there are no solutions, and I think, for instance, the fact that the borough workers agreed to a two-tier contract is the road in which maybe even you are talking about. What I mean by that is, we negotiated with the borough workers this past contract. Tony, myself, Ralph, and a few other people were there. Robin was there too. And, it was a tough negotiation. And what they ultimately, I think, saw is what you're addressing, and that is there's not much more money to go around. And so that two-tier, I definitely think, is something that all unions should consider. I'm a member of a union, and it's something that, as a byline, we do not support. but I, you know, that's just, that is the company line, that's just the line that you keep. We do not, as a union, support a two-tier contract. But, you know, as a pragmatist, I think certainly people need to consider that, and we, you know, obviously, Tony and Ralph and I debate about a lot of stuff, but we agreed on that. And so, I guess just to your point, we are working on those types of things, and the two-tier contract, I think, was a step in the right direction.
Any new borough employee comes in a lot less than any employee that's here.
I realize that. This last contract for the municipal workers, you dropped it like 12 bucks an hour or something, the starting from 30 to 18, which is pretty significant. That's somebody's job there, $12 an hour. But why didn't that happen the previous contract? Where were the negotiations then?
This all started, though, I don't mean to be flip or sarcastic, which I've been called online, but this didn't start with us, Kenny. This started 20 years ago, where you know, people were kept working and they were kept the no layoff clause. Do you think this council ever would have inserted a no layoff clause? A clause whereby public works don't pay $1 towards their medical benefits.
Exactly.
Again, so don't look, I'm sorry, but don't look at this council and say, this is terrible. We inherited, along with a building that was dilapidated.
Yeah, but contracts...
department that was 9 years for that. I mean, please, you know...
But contracts, I'm sorry to interrupt, aren't 10, 20 years old. I mean, well, you said the police worked for nine...
Base salaries are...
Last year, a non-uniform contract. Robin, me, Tony, and Greg. Did we come out of there with a good contract? They all got raises.
For the union? I mean, for the uniform? Or the non-uniform you're talking about?
The police is up next year.
The non-uniform.
Non-uniform, we all gave them a raise. And this council...
This last contract was good.
Why was it good?
Because you...
Why, tell me.
Brought, you looked at reality. How the private sector, yeah, I think so, whoever was on that negotiating committee this last time.
They get a raise.
But I want to know who's... I want to know who...
Asking you a question.
Did they get raised? I think it was more of a fair contract.
Did they get a raise?
What did they get? I don't know.
They got a raise like they got every other year prior to that contract. They didn't get any more, or if it was anything, it was right around what they always got.
All right. Let me just back up real quick, because...
I know what you're getting at, Kenny. You're getting at that prior contracts, we made a mistake. You should come and negotiate a contract.
And do you know, just as again, because I was with these guys, how many hours, Tony, that we set, that we ordered. And you're sitting, my friend, with union reps. And they're not the friendliest people in the world.
We stayed strong. It took over 1 year to negotiate that contract. What do you think? We just walked in and said, here's a contract, or the cops come in and we just say, here, take what you want?
Here's what I'm getting.
How about Kenny? They walk out, slam the door. We walk out, slam. Right, guys? Am I right?
I think right now you're wasting our time.
Let me finish.
Really do, not making sense about a contract that you weren't involved in. You didn't sit behind
But I still have to pay. I still have to pay for this.
Behind closed doors and how hard the four of us worked to make that contract. Or how many before us, how hard it was to settle a contract.
So,
you know what's wrong with the borough right now?
What?
The $24 million is generating no money.
That's what I'm getting at.
So
if it was
generating the money, 50%, it would have should have generated last year's budget and this year's budget, we wouldn't have an issue with.
All right, and I agree.
Finish what you want to say so I can end this.
Thank you. Now, first of all, I want to say that I realize we're going through a police shortage right now. All right, when I'm talking about salaries and all, I saw the payroll of uniform, non-uniform teachers and everything. I was like,
we don't have nothing to do with teachers.
I understand you don't. I understand.
Go to the school board.
All right, I intend to.
Go there and talk.
I intend to. But what I'm saying is also, it's not that I don't think most of our police officers, our municipal workers, our teachers, aren't worth what they're paid. But can Little Bristol Borough afford it? No.
So what's the solution?
They can't. Wait, what? No, I'm getting, let me get there. In closing, all right, where am I at here? Over the last 10 years or so, most of us had to tighten our household budgets. All levels of government needed to do the same and did not. We've been hearing over the last year or so in Bristol Borough that the investment return is way down, the return on investment way down from previous years. You just said it 2 minutes ago. Hundreds of thousands of dollars. Okay. Why, if you're down hundreds of thousands, I mean, I just don't understand that train of thought or that logic to, well, we have to raise taxes or come up with some other sources because our investment's down. Well, I don't, if I'm buying a new house, I don't count my overtime as part of my income to determine my mortgage because I don't know if that overtime is going to be there. I just think it was poor judgment to think you're going to get $500,000 or $600,000 back on this investment. You only get $200,000 or $300,000 back. That's what I wanted to say.
Wasn't it councils 20 years ago that used the interest off the loan when it was $1.2 million and made it a part of the operating budget? That's where that started. Just so you know.
I don't
just
know.
I do know.
I'm here now and worried about the taxpayers now.
It's very simple. It's very simple. For the last 13 years that I'm sitting here, there were two tax increases. One to pay the mortgage on the rink. One, because the borough was so far in debt, the only way to do it was to raise taxes. We're touching $24 million. So that were the two tax increases. Last year, there was a tax increase because we went into a recession that the money, and out of that tax increase, 2 mils or 2.5 mils or whatever it was,
75.
Went to the fire department.
1.75.
To pay for radio.
And I was all for that.
This year.
Well.
So, your property taxes that you pay in this town and for the services that you get in this town should be very happy to live here. And guess what? If you're not happy, you got an option. Either elect a new council next year or move out of town. Because people want to stand at that podium and say, we're making the wrong decisions for Bristol. Why weren't you sitting up here 10 years ago telling people about the decisions were made for this town? When you couldn't go in that bathroom and wash your hands. Why wouldn't you stand here when every street in Bristol had potholes in it and there were no street lights, no borough building, the police were getting changed in a hallway? Why didn't you stand
here and criticize the other
councils
prior
to us?
Do you want me to answer
all
that?
Why weren't
you here? Do you want to have time for
that? You can do anything you want. Because you got a lot to say when you stand at that podium. You never stood there one time and said, you know what? All you guys, mayor, council, the chief, you guys are doing a great job for this town. You come up here and you want to nickel and dime every meeting about taxes. Oh, I can't afford it. Guess what? Move. That's the price of living here.
Well,
would you rather live in a town that is the way it is today, or would you rather have lived in this town that was 15 years ago? Just answer that question. What would you rather have? A state-of-the-art police station, a state-of-the-art borough building, a state-of-the-art maintenance building, trucks, cars, everything they need to run this borough, or plows on every truck instead of waiting until there was 6 or 8 inches of snow to get your streets plowed. We can go back to them days. It's very simple. Or we need to step with the times.
But you act like
things cost money to continue this town.
You act like nothing positive ever happened prior to your...
Oh, I know things positive happened since before.
Yeah.
Yeah, tell me what happened. They put a walking path in town.
A walking path?
Yeah.
You know what, though? I don't want
to say that. No, I want to hear what you got to say. I want to hear what you got
to say.
Let me, what do you have to say?
All right. The lagoon, revitalization. I'm just saying what happened, but there were officials that were involved in getting that done. Okay. The Grundy Clock revitalization.
Grundy Clock?
Yeah. You don't remember that? That was before you were on council.
Mm-hmm.
That was going to be condemned. Did you know that?
Okay, go ahead.
All right. Yeah, the walking path, home run, the best thing that ever happened to this borough.
You're right.
All right. And how many problem bars and dilapidated properties were acquired through the years? I mean, we can name how many bars used to be on every other corner in this town. Okay. I can name some more things, but all with keeping taxes low. We were a low tax haven in this town. Okay. You realize, you just said about the couple of tax increases that occurred under your tenure, but you realize, or do people realize that municipal taxes doubled from 2004 to 2006? They doubled.
Okay.
So in 2 years. Wait a minute. Let me finish. And in 2008, you did pay off an old loan that was five or six mils? I know. But wait a minute. I want to make a point. Wait, you moved that money from debt service into the general fund. Wait a minute. And do you realize that other municipalities have what's called a sunset rule? When they take money, they take a loan out. When that loan is paid off, it's done. It doesn't get moved. The money, the revenue doesn't, the taxes don't get moved to another area of the pie. It's a sunset. It's done. That's not what happened. So in reality, taxes did go up in 2009.
That's your theory.
Well, sure. But if that loan wasn't paid off, you would have had to raise taxes, right?
Can we start to
talk? And it was the last payment. Huh?
Can we start to wrap up?
I apologize. I know.
I know.
And don't get me wrong. Yes, you have done some nice things, and I apologize. I apologize for not commenting on some of the highlights.
You don't have to apologize because I really don't care.
But we don't.
I'm tired of hearing people step up at that podium and want to criticize this council. I'm tired of it.
But you're looking for more revenue from people that they don't have. People don't have it.
Come May, the people of this town will have a decision to elect your group or our group. It's a very simple decision to make. If they want to go in the direction you want to go and Mr. Devine want to go, they elect your team. If they want to stay with the way we're moving Bristol, they elect our team. Very simple. Come May, we'll find out what happens. So there's no reason to sit here and prep and come here and try to get everybody to understand. It's all about an election. So come May, we're going to find out. I don't care. If Mr. Devine's group or your group takes over, God bless you. I don't need it. Don't you understand? I'm being honest with you.
Can I ask you one more question, Mr. President?
Say what you want to say, criticize.
One more question, and I'll sit down. One more question. Where do you see Bristol in 5 years?
Probably a lot better than it is today.
Financially?
Financially, yes.
A lot better? Okay, thank you.
Because with all the new construction that's going on,
okay.
People invest. You know what's ruining Bristol? Guys like you standing at that podium. Guys like you knocking this town down. Having stuff in the newspaper about shootings on Spruce and Race and Buckley Street. Armed robberies. That's what takes our town down.
I put that in there?
Not you. People in the newspaper. Would you want to move into Bristol here? Well, there was a shooting on Spruce Street or this on, you know, that's the stuff that should be kept in the police department.
Oh, I'm glad you said that.
We're sitting here saying we're the biggest, highest taxes in the county. Who wants to come here? What do you?
Exactly.
What do we have the
You're offer? Right. Why would someone want to come here? But Sergeant Moore stood up here a couple months ago and said, you know, the police department's in crisis. And maybe we should consider merging with another police department.
Maybe that's the solution.
Maybe it is. Maybe
and
it should
I have
be
investigated. No
maybe it should be investigated.
Up, which we got into this wasting time with you tonight, because I was going to talk about maybe a merger somewhere down the road.
Well, you brought up public participation. You could. I didn't.
And you talked about nothing that made sense to
no,
me.
No, but I don't.
In
I
your
said
mind.
No, it did make
your
sense.
Mind.
And I said. Previous
Kenny,
you've
been criticizing us for since we've been here.
No, that's not true.
No, it is true. That's and true. That's fine. That's your opinion. Everybody has one, Mr. Devine.
Yeah, I just want to, Mr. President, for you to really to attack.
I can do what
Mr.
I want, Tony.
I
don't have to listen to him every time he
it's
steps
not,
up there.
All I'm going to say, I just want to stick
Look,
up.
You're
going to
protect somebody that's on your side.
It's not. Listen.
Come on, Tony. Let's stop.
It's not what I'm going to tell you right now. You can you look motion. This guy. This guy. Yeah, listen.
Meeting adjourned. That's all.